You know, Jeff, because we don't stream, we're not live. We're all recorded and stuff. The folks on the in the audience never get to see us set things up. One of my favorite things to do, watching all the folks that do stream, like Twit and some of the other shows, is watch them while they're getting everything all Santa.
It's the season.
Well, that's cool.
Yeah, yeah. Can yeah, you... it's very whimsical.
I understand it does tricks.
It does tricks?
Yes.
You've been talking to Bobby.
Yeah.
She likes this one.
Is it resonant on any particular frequency?
3 hertz, maybe.
Have you tried loading it up?
No.
Okay. Well, you can, and I understand it doesn't stay on very well.
Yeah, it's kind of loose on me here. I really ought to fix it because I like it.
Yeah, that would be cool.
So, it'll get a laugh at work tomorrow.
Okay, so we're going to take the hat off and switch the camera back to normal position.
Okay. There we go. Oh, I can hear better.
I think that's reasonable. So what I was saying was that, and the reason why you see me look over here, things are we're getting close to having the studio set up the way I want it. But the Wirecast is over here, and I have to kind of look over here to switch the picture. Yeah. Jeff has got my program monitor pointed at him, so he can see what's going on. Oh, it's going to shove it closer to you, too.
The program monitor? Oh.
If I can. I put too many more wires across the table. See,
and this was the part you wanted to show.
It is.
It's interesting.
Yeah, because we don't stream live. People never get to see the stuff getting set up. So right. I thought we'd just do right. a little bit of that. So we got my shot. We got your shot. I've got an over-the-shoulder shot for me, which shows my monitor. And I'm going to actually tilt that down to look close up down here at some other stuff. I've got my monitor. And then we've got you and your close-up shot. Oh, stick a hand in there.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to have to adjust that a little bit. And a camera pointed right at me if I look this way, but it's a webcam, and for some reason it doesn't get the full frame rate. It's real slow, so we won't be using that too much. And I think that's all. So that's what we got going.
Okay.
So I guess we can start the episode. This is episode 107. Am I on here? Yeah, okay. I can't tell that I'm on.
Not when you're looking this way.
So this is Ham Radio Now, episode 107. And the name of this one is Kickstarting Orlando and Dayton Video Coverage. Reaction
Kickstarting.
Shot.
Kickstarting. Yeah. Are you... I don't want to steal your thunder. Are you going to do a Kickstarter?
Yeah, the Kickstarter for Tapper was quite successful.
Yeah, you weren't expecting it to be, were you?
No, well, I gave it less than 50%. So
you were hopeful.
Yeah. I operate on the concept of high hopes and low expectations. So
low disappointment.
Yeah. So I was hoping it would be successful. Yeah. All on the other hand, it was a lot of work. I really enjoyed the trip driving out there. Uh-huh. Had a good time. Had a good time talking to you on the radio from Ohio and from Idaho.
Right.
Yeah, that was pretty awesome.
Yeah, I haven't got my card yet.
Yeah, and you're not ever going to, because I got some QSLs. I'll send one if somebody. Yeah, I didn't get yours either. So.
Yeah, okay.
So I had a good time driving out and playing on the radio. I had a good time driving back too, but as you know, that turned out to be a fast.
Yeah, yeah, wasn't at all what you were looking forward to.
No. I also talked to Cliff, W4FT, but none of that made it on to, didn't have the recorder running, but yeah. I talked to him from way out on the far west coast.
Is he coming to the studio tonight?
No, he is not, so I'm doing all the switching myself.
Oh,
it's a one-man band operation over here.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So, this camera can probably... Yeah, this camera shows how the Wirecast thing is set up, sort of, although I'm pushing buttons down here just a little bit out of frame, so you can't see that happen.
Right.
Yes. You stuck your mouth open as if you're going to say something.
Oh, no. I'm just catching flies.
Oh, it was kind of like the little kids at the restaurant, the real little kids at the restaurant, you know, that are been up past their bedtime and they got their mouth open. And, you know, the longer they hold that mouth open, the louder it's going to be when they find
out. Oh, yeah. Or like an injured little child that gets injured, they wind up really good.
Yep. And then when they let it, the longer they're, yep. the louder it's going
to
be when they
get. It gives you more time to get your fingers in your ears.
it would give the parents time to get the kids out of the restaurant, but they're clueless.
Well, I think they know what's coming and they're just shuddering too.
Yeah. All right. So, the Kickstarter for Tapper was successful, and we have done Dayton stuff and Orlando stuff and Huntsville stuff. I got to keep my hand up here. I got to be ready to push the button at a moment's notice to get the other shot.
In case I say something.
In case you say something, yeah. So we've done those ham fests and things, and the viewer contributions to cover the costs of going there and putting the programs on haven't really kept up. That's not a big surprise. Everybody who depends on contributions for things generally doesn't get a big return on those.
Right.
Yeah, NPR, PBS, those guys know it. They exist on contributions from about 4% of their audience. My brother is he's now the CEO. He'd been the general manager. He's now the CEO of a public station out in the Rock Island, Quad Cities, Illinois,
in
the Iowa area. And I got to get him on here on Skype sometime, and he can tell me all about this fundraising thing, because he's very successful at it.
Okay.
He's got a lot of new money for the station that hired him a couple of years ago. So it's WVIK, the Vike, because the football team for the college, it's Augustana College. The football team is the Vikings.
Uh-huh.
So the radio station is WVIK.
I used to work in Durham at WTIK.
And what did you do?
I was a Sunday morning DJ.
You was the morning DJ on WTIK.
Yeah.
What was the format?
They were, it was country. Mm-hmm. They were 5,000 watts on a local channel, 1310.
Did they play both kinds of music?
Country and Western, yeah. Yeah, but I only did that till about 8 o'clock in the morning, and then that's when all the preachers came on. So some of them had 30-minute spots, some had 15. One guy came in and did his preaching live every Sunday morning. That was interesting. Most of them were a recording or a remote.
Yeah, I can make substantial portion of the audience mad by doing my imitation of the on the radio preacher.
The Harry,
God wants you to send us money. that pretty close.
They weren't real bad about it then.
No, they were more subtle about.
They actually were more into the message than the business. At least the ones on that small station there.
Yeah.
I don't know what they were paying. They probably weren't paying much for
the
time.
That's because that's why they're on the small station. If they were better at it, they'd be on TV and then do the televangelist thing. So
yeah.
So if I've made somebody mad, I have. It happens. Tends to happen.
Well, I hope you didn't.
I hope not. But yeah. You know, anyway, so where were we? Oh, Kickstarter. So. Here on the wrong button. There we go. So we did the Kickstarter at Tapper, and it, like I say, it was quite successful. But we have been to the other Hamfest, and we've done a lot of programs. And here's what I wanted to do. We have to make a video for the Kickstarter.
Okay.
So what I wanted to do was embed making that in this program.
Oh, okay.
And so we'll spend a few minutes doing that, and then we'll go on to do other stuff. We got a bunch of other stuff to do. It's got nothing to do with kickstarting Orlando.
That's a good thing. It's early in the day.
Yeah, we're burning time fast. So let's begin the Kickstarter. Ham Radio Now Kickstarter for video coverage of the Orlando and Dayton Hamventions right here on Ham Radio Now. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and with me here in the studio is my buddy Jeff.
Jeff Wittick, AC4ZL.
And the two of us, along with our pal Cliff, have been to the HamFest before, doing Ham Radio Now videos. You know, I needed to figure out a way to fund going to, well, doing things for Ham Radio Now. And the Kickstarter for the Tapper Digital Communications Conference was quite successful. I got the right button. Yeah, there we go. So it ended up being quite successful, as you know. You didn't get to go out there with me. Nobody right. did. I hired some local guys to do video out there. So I was thinking, how do I go to this well again? how do I tap this source? I don't know if we're going to be successful on this. You know, as usual, I'll have the high hopes and low expectations on being able to do this. But Kickstarter requires that you have a specific project. You can't just say fund Ham Radio Now for an unlimited period of time by sending money to a Kickstarter. It's got to be a specific project. So I was thinking, well, what do we do that's specific? And one of the things that we do that's easy to show, because we've done it before, is we go to HamFest. And at the HamFest, we cover... we generally do kind of a tour.
I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and we are down here at the Orlando HamCation, K4NRG, the Nerd Repeater Group.
This is a PRC-6 walkie-talkie, a military in the 1950s.
This guy right here is what I believe to be the most portable tower in the world for ham, guys.
I'm running out of air.
We're in commercial building 1 and 2. That's the way they designate it here at the Orlando HamCation.
We're live from the Dayton Hamvention.
No, that's the goal.
Not quite there yet, but
not quite there yet. This is the Pearl, the Contour, the Magnetic Classic.
It has an iambic double paddle.
And I love to see people feeling good about amateur radio.
We're at the Icon booth, and Ray Novak has let us loose with the brand new ICOM 7100.
And lately we've done sit down interviews.
Yeah.
And sometimes we do walk around interviews.
Yeah. Yeah. So. A lot more interviews than tour here in the last couple of years.
Thanks for the opportunity to be here and chat with you, Gary.
I love a good fight.
Something big has happened.
That's right. We're very excited. We have a launch of our satellite.
So that's what we've been doing. And the programs have been reasonably popular, but they haven't. The contributions that we've gotten from doing them haven't covered the expenses, much less paid much for sitting here doing all the work. So I thought, well, let's try a Kickstarter, and we will isolate it to HamFests and see how that works. Okay. First, the Kickstarter guys have to approve the project. And so this video will be one of the things they'll look at, along with the other stuff that I stick up about approving the project. Yeah, you were going to say something.
Yeah, yeah. So two HamFests. You're going to have one project with two HamFests.
I wanted to do something that would be a little bit easier than doing it over and over and over again. So I thought, well, I'll stick two HamFests in one, two begs in one asket. Get that? don't put all your begs in one asket. Have you ever heard that?
Yeah. Okay. Well, not like that.
So two begs in one asket. Mm-hmm. And then if that is successful, coming up later this year is the ARRL convention. It's in July up in Hartford. And then the Huntsville HamFest in Alabama. Yeah. And those are the ones we've typically gone to. I would like to squeeze in Dallas, HamCon.
Yeah.
In Dallas. But that's in June. So if this is successful, we will see what else we can do.
June is a tough month for traveling. You know, field day, and it's the birthday and anniversary month for a lot of us.
Yeah, I think it's early in June, so
that'd be good.
Yeah, so those are some possibilities, but we'll concentrate on doing the Orlando and Dayton, the two names I keep getting screwed up.
Okay.
So that's what this Kickstarter will be all about. Now, again, we've got a track record. We've been to Dayton several years. We've been to Orlando. In fact, the first time I took you, I think, was like 2008.
I've been to 7.
With me for this trip is my friend Jeff, AC4ZO. This is Jeff's first trip to Dayton. Yes, Jeff is a Dayton version.
And we made DVDs for a few years, and then we started doing this stuff online.
Right.
And the DVDs sold, okay, you know, a few hundred. and the online stuff seen by thousands, but contributed to by dozens. So anyway, so that's the deal. You're going to be shocked by how much money I want people to contribute for something like this. Are you ready to?
Will the goal be?
Okay, the goal is going to be a grand total of $8,000. Shocked face, please.
For the $8,000. Yeah, well, you know, you always pay all the expenses. I have no idea what it costs to go to these shows. I've never had to pay any of it.
Well, I've done some back of the envelope calculating here. Mileage wise, going to Orlando is about 1,300 miles round trip, and the IRS lets you bill if you're getting mileage back 55 cents a mile. So that's $700. It's around $300 a day or so in a hotel and food for all the people put together. There's airfare for Cindy because she doesn't drive with us. And that's a wild card, I'm guessing, for about $300. And then if I'm getting paid to do this, stand by for a reaction shot. Okay. If I'm getting paid to do this, you're getting paid to do this. You're laughing. We're talking $100 a day, $300.
Okay, well, that's a new wrinkle, a whole new way of doing things.
Yeah, give me that shocked face. $300 for you, nigga.
for the weekend? Oh my goodness, I wouldn't have to take my own spending money.
You got it, and then finally,
can I get that in rolls of nickels?
And you can't get it in writing either. Well, it'll be here on the video. And then finally, for me, I'm going to pay myself. How much am I going to pay myself? You ready for shocked face?
Whatever Cindy says, I guess.
Here's shocked face. So, I'll mention the number, but I'll put Jeff's picture on
$3,000.
$3,000. $3,000. Yeah. This is for both of them rolled up. That's for the time on the weekend and then all the editing and all the extra work it takes to put stuff together. So that,
so you're going to end up making like $10 an hour.
Almost, yeah. It seems like a lot of money, but it doesn't work out to being that much for any one thing.
Yeah, I know how much time it takes. We used to go out and do ham stuff and non-ham stuff all the time, and now it's been 8 or 10 years since we've just gone off and done stuff.
Yeah. So you're not actually planning on working Dayton with me this year until I mentioned the $300.
I'm going to Dayton, but it'll be my eighth trip. But I won't be working with you this time.
Yeah, because you have wanted to do HamFest stuff, and I cut you loose to do a little bit of HamFest stuff. Yeah. But you look around at everything around you and say,
that what do I say?
you wish you could go see more of the HamFest,
especially the flea market at Dayton. But you know, it's and you've been very good about giving me as much time as possible. But it's in snippets and stuff, and I'm scared to get very far away from the booth because if you call and something big has come, you know, something very unusual is passing by, or a person that is difficult to get time with is available for a short period of time. I just want to get back, you know, in minutes, not tens of minutes.
Yeah. So, and you've been pretty good about it. So sometimes you're hard to reach, but most of the time you've been pretty good. My tablet just faded out. It's got all my notes on it. Oh. There we go. So that's the deal. A total of $8,000. The way I'm thinking about breaking it out, it was also successful with Tapper to have some of it paid for at the corporate contribution level.
Nice, right?
And some by individual contribution. So what I'm going to set up is a corporate level of $500, and I'll set up 10 of those. So that'll be 5,000 of the 8,000. And 3,000, I don't know that I'll get that, but it'll be possible. And 3,000 for individual contributions. At this point, I don't know what to tell people about how I'll do commercials and things like that. If I've got 10 contributors at the corporate level at $500, they'll get something significant in the programs, but I don't know right now just how much. A little bit of this is still too back of the envelope.
Yeah.
So, you know what would be great is if I could show some of the Tapper programs, but I haven't put any of them together yet.
Yeah.
We did put one out right away. The Yaesu announcement of their digital repeater came out right away.
Hi, everyone. My name is Dennis Motschenbacher. I'm a K7BV.
Did you watch that?
No, I don't watch your shows.
Over Thanksgiving, none of my family.
So tomorrow they're going to start coming out.
Well, tomorrow I start editing the first one.
Oh, okay.
And then I don't have the commercial stuff ready for you. I haven't finished all the work it takes with the sponsors to put their commercials in, but that won't take long once I get some graphics and some copy from them. So, So those things will come out. It could be in the second week in December, and then they'll come out quickly, you know, almost one a day until we're done, which should be by the end of the month to maybe early in January. Last year, they trickled out deep into February, and I don't see that happening. I think they'll come out faster.
Well, that's good. We are in the busy season, though. You know, it's just the beginning of December, so there's lots of family functions that are going to cut into your editing time.
Yeah. So we're still doing the Kickstarter here. We need to wrap this up because they want that to be short.
Okay.
So you've seen what we've done. And hamradionow.tv, you can see all that stuff. Just go take a look. I think just about everybody who's watching this, like the folks who watch the Tapper stuff, understand what we do. So this is just your opportunity to be able to kick in if this is successful. If you're seeing this just on Ham Radio Now, Kickstarter said no. If you're seeing it, and we'll make the big ballyhoo about Kickstarter, if they say go, we'll do it on Kickstarter. If Kickstarter says no, then we might try one of the other ones, or we might just say, no, we're not going to do it. We'll see. What was the other thing I needed to say about this? Oh, if it's not successful, you know, if the Kickstarter says, sure, give it a try, and it's not successful, it doesn't raise the money, we won't go. I may still go to the Hamfest. You're still going to go to the Hamfest.
Well, I'm going to Dayton. I won't go to Orlando.
Yeah.
I won't go to Orlando without you.
Okay. Don't leave for Orlando without me. So I'm getting backwards on switching the picture, as you can see. And I can't see the picture if I'm looking at you. I don't know what I'm doing.
Can you see the back of your head on the monitor I'm looking at here?
Oh, I didn't realize. Yeah. But it's very dark. So so that's the deal. If it's not successful, we just, you know, I may still go to some, I probably go to Dayton. I probably wouldn't go to Orlando. Oh, the other thing is that it's already too late for me to secure my booth at Orlando. They sent me email yesterday saying, you got to poop or get off the pot. So I said, let that booth go. That's an expensive booth. I didn't even put the booth costs in here. At Orlando, it's 300 something. Dayton, it's about 600. So I didn't even put those costs in here.
Is that for the weekend or per day?
That's for the whole weekend. Orlando will have space in the back of Commercial 3. They've always had some empty space, or a flea market building or someplace, if we need to be able to set up. And Dayton has always had some room in the back of one of the buildings. So we don't need that upfront exposure. It's nice. Mostly what it meant is people kept coming up to us to say how much they liked the show, and we couldn't get anything else done.
Well, when you were selling DVDs, that spot you were in there at Dayton was a good one. But, you know, if you're going to set up a studio and bring people in, it's not so critical.
Yeah, not quite so necessary. So that's it for the Kickstarter. You'll see the details on the screen, kind of like this one was. And if you're interested in getting this out there for those Hamfests. You know, we can do stuff without being at a Hamfest. That's not what I meant to say. Well, yeah, it is. We can do interviews without being at a Hamfest. The advantage of being at a Hamfest is there's lots of people there, and I can arm twist them and get them to sit down and do the interview with them fast.
Right.
And when it's set up on Skype, sometimes it's difficult to get all the stuff put together to make all that work. And tell you what, that's the end of the video for the Kickstarter. Contribute if you like, and we'll maybe see you at Orlando and Dayton. Thanks very much. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
Jeff Wittick, AC4ZO.
Who would be at Orlando, and you'd see him in the background at Dayton. Over.
And out.
Okay. End of the Kickstarter. The thing about doing things at the Hamfest is you can get the people there right away. On Skype, you think, well, you know, it's going to be easy. an awful lot of people have never used Skype video. And for those that have, they are not very well set up. For some reason, and I don't know why, people don't set up studios in their houses with lighting and microphones and all that stuff.
Yeah, and on Skype, I don't think people are as candid as they are when they're sitting there right at the table with you.
Well, that may be. I also, though, have my patented interviewing technique, which draws people out. It may be a little more difficult on Skype, but I tend to draw people out. One of the benefits of the long-form interviews that we do is that people have a chance to finally get around to saying something. When, you know, it can take a while to get them warmed up and going. And I could edit, I suppose, and cut out some of the stuff. But
in the short ones, it's what they say after the interview that would be gold for during the interview.
And that's the case even with the long ones. And even at the ham fests, when things are bustling, we stop the cameras, and that's when the best comment comes out.
Yeah.
So nothing you can do about that. That's human nature. And you wonder why. Because what they're saying was not particularly secret. You know, nothing that would embarrass anybody. It's just that they didn't say it until the camera was off.
It's a lot less sterile after the camera's off.
Yeah, that's true. And I try real hard to keep the interviews from being too sterile. Again, with the long-form interviews, they will warm up after a while.
Right.
But it sometimes takes a while. So that's the deal for the Kickstarter. We'll see how that works out. I wanted to say something that I just never take the chance to say, and that is to the contributors. You know, I'm always pointing to Arvin back there and asking people to come to hamradionow.tv and click the pig. I don't very often say that's hard to do. It's not physically, not technically hard to do. It is. To get off your butt and go do that is not something that most people are willing to do. And the folks that do it, and especially the folks that do it more than once, you guys are awesome. I mean, reaction shot.
Yeah, they are. and I'm proud to say that I have contributed, but I might be a single-time contributor. I'm not sure.
You're in your $10 a year 1 year past. You're out of date. Your expiration
date. Am I overdue?
Your expiration date is... You have a free pass. You have a get-out-of-jail-free card.
Oh.
So, don't worry about it. But for the folks that have contributed, I appreciate it. The fact is that there are about 10% of you that I really need. There's about 400 or so, 450. And we need to be in the thousands, not the hundreds. But even to get, for everyone who has done it, you've done something great. You've done something, to me, it's great. To the rest of the world, it's, you know, okay, nice. I realize the number of things that I participate in or watch or whatever that, they're seeking donations, contributions, whatever. And some of them get some money from me, but a lot of them don't. So thank you very much. Good job.
You know what I appreciate from the contributors more than the money they give you? And that's because it's me, not you. But
you don't get any of the money.
All the little gifts, you know, the pig beer and stuff like that. I just love that stuff.
We haven't got a lot of that, but we've got a little bit of it. Yeah. And it's pretty cool. All right. Let's see. What next on my rundown list here is Halloween. You're not going to hear this properly, but I'm going to push a couple buttons here.
Turn the dial. And I should never do this. Let me make sure I'm being recorded. I think I am, and I think I'm recording what I think I'm recording. Let me make sure. Okay, good. Yeah, there it is. I should never do this, because this is the voice I want to have all the time.
So it's just, now I sound like a little girl.
You're right. You should never do that.
What were you hearing? Were you hearing that? Or were you just hearing me?
I think I was just hearing you trying to sound like the output of your box.
Oh, yeah. Now the folks, you'll hear it. And you heard it. At Halloween.
Yeah.
I set that up for Halloween. Here's, let's see. I got to get to the right picture. That's what we did for Halloween. that is a big blow up cat, and being the technically astute audio and video person that I am, I set up the little mixer, this mixer, and the cat and microphone.
It's on a stand up there.
Yeah, there's the microphone and a speaker underneath. And I'd put the sound
like this, and I said, "Hi, I'm Bob, Bob the cat."
I am hearing a pitch bender there.
Okay, good. And the little kids in the neighborhood came up, and they're just blown away. As Cindy has said, they forgot to get candy. That's how much. And the cat's head swivels back and forth. This is just a still picture. The cat's head swivels back and forth, and you know, it's lit up and all that. And I have the big bright lights in the background to make it hard to see. I'm in the window back here behind that big bright light, so they can't see that it's me. And the kids had a good time.
There was a dog that just was scared to death. He was getting closer and closer and closer to the cat. And when the cat swung his head, that dog took about 10 sideways leaps away from it, all the way to the far side of the driveway. Did you see it?
Yeah. Cindy's actually got some video of that. That was Halloween. We just wrapped up the Thanksgiving weekend. This is Sunday, the end of the Thanksgiving weekend. Did you eat too much?
I ate more than I deserved, but I don't know that it was too much.
Yeah, I busted the calorie budget.
I have made it to the gym, though, the last 2 days.
Yeah, I worked out every day except for Thursday. We had to get on the road early. So
I miss Wednesday and Thursday, because Wednesday was cooking the pigs, you know.
Yeah, you spend all night long. Yeah. Cooking pigs for what group?
It's a high school booster club where my daughter-in-law is an English teacher.
Okay, and you do it with your son.
Mm-hmm.
Your son is KE4CTW.
Right, KE4CTW.
A call sign that has appeared on the air approximately, what, once?
No, when he first got it, he was 14, I think, and there were some high school kids within simplex range that he would talk to occasionally, a couple times a week, really, in the evening, after net time, for about a month, I guess, that went on. And now, I don't know the last time he was on the air with that call sign.
Well, he moved away, so he doesn't live around here anymore.
Right. He's 100 miles away.
Yeah. You could talk to him on, mm-hmm. you know, repeaters on, they don't have a D-Star down there, but he could get a D-Vap or something and talk to you. But no interest, right?
Yeah, no interest, no. He's like a lot of us. He's not looking for more things to keep him busy.
Well, yeah. I mean, ham radio goes with you. It could be something you spend a lot of time just focusing on doing ham radio, or it could just be with you as a handy talkie, mobile radio, whatever. And
if his peer group were hams, I'm sure they would use it.
Yeah, his peer group is technical because he works for a cable company.
Yeah.
So, but nobody else is a ham.
Right.
I'm switching wrong again. gotten out of sync. All right. Yeah. So anyway, that's your wife is also a ham, not active.
Yeah.
You know, your wife. Well, I don't know about your wife. My mother-in-law, Cindy's wife. Slow down. Cindy's mom got her ham license because before the era of ubiquitous cell phones. The family would go do stuff, and there'd be enough of us that it would take two, sometimes three cars to ferry everybody back and forth to the various places. One of them was down at the beach. He joined us down at the beach several years.
Yeah.
And she saw how convenient it was that we were all able to talk back and forth, because I'm a ham, Cindy's a ham, her dad's a ham. And she snuck to a radio club class and got her tech license. And then the cell phones came out. She doesn't actually use the cell phone that much either. Neither of her parents do. They don't leave them on. And there are people whose idea of a cell phone is, I will turn it on when I want to make a call.
Right.
You reaching me, not a critical factor.
Right. Right. And they probably never check their messages.
Over the weekend, for the very first time, we showed her how to get into her voicemail. And there were messages more than a year old.
Oh, dear.
So we got to those. All right. So that's Thanksgiving. The next on my list is PowerPoles. So the reason I've got PowerPoles on the list is I was watching Ham Nation's episode from last Wednesday, the pre-Thanksgiving episode, the last show on the Twit Network before they basically shut down for the weekend until yesterday when Leo came back to do the Tech Guy show. They didn't do any new shows on Thursday or Friday. That was pretty cool. So George did his Smoke and Solder segment on doing PowerPoles. George, you missed some things. you missed some important stuff. So you've got some power poles sitting over there, and you've got this close-up cam. Can you see what you're doing on the close-up cam?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So I was explaining to you a little bit, but I wanted to keep things as fresh as possible here for what George missed. And the most critical thing that he missed was to getting rowdy downstairs.
Oh,
I don't think the mics are picking it up, but I can hear them. I did holler, you know, we're on the air. You know, that was a half hour ago. I've totally forgotten.
Well, they're having fun.
Yeah. I could holler now. I could holler.
Nah, don't. You know,
shut up. No. Okay. So there is a polarity decision that you've got to make with power poles. It is one of two possible ways. And the decision is not a technical one. It's purely social.
Right.
It's purely everyone deciding to do things the same way.
Right.
And so we went to power poles because nobody had compatible connectors in ham radio. Everybody had some different kind of connector. Well, just after the hams decided to go to power poles, everybody started putting the same connectors on their radios. The manufacturers, they all went to the same connection on the radios. And there was a brief time when a round cinch Jones plug was used.
Yep.
But then this power pole thing came out. And what George didn't say was that you could assemble them two ways.
Actually, four ways.
Yeah, it's true, four ways. And if you assemble them wrong, well, you can assemble them side by side and pick up your power poles and see if you can follow along as I'm. You can assemble them side by side like that, or you can assemble them vertically like that. And they could go either way. Oh, you know what? We're going to put the power pole discussion on hold for a second, because one of the things we needed to do is add additional lighting to your area.
Okay.
And I came up with lights for you.
Thank you. Yeah, that one's great here. Yeah,
all around here are LED lights. They're just cheap little LED lights in cheap fixtures. As cheap as LED lights get. Let me see if can you hold the LED light up. Yeah, there it is. I mean, it is designed as much like a standard incandescent bulb as possible. There's something wrong with that one. Shake it a little bit.
Oh, yeah, I hear.
Whoops. Yeah, hold it up by the mic there. Yeah, it's not supposed to do that, but I tested it. It will still work. At some point, it might blow up, so we'll find out. So go ahead and plug it in that lamp fixture. It didn't blow up when I did it, so you might be okay. And switch it on. And we've got to do one more thing. We have to put the scrim in front of it. So that's sitting over there. And we're going to do it just with plain old Scotch tape. And one of the reasons we can get away with that and the tape won't melt and everything will fall off is it's not going to get hot. It's burning up about 8 watts for all that light. So that's very cool.
Yeah, I put a bunch of those in my shack in the ceiling, 6 of them.
Yeah, so probably a lot of you have switched to LED lighting. That bulb was about $12. So it's equivalent as a 40 or 60 watt incandescent bulb will be about $1.50. But assuming that the rattle isn't a problem, and I'll go probably take it back to the store and swap it out, Sam. It's not supposed to rattle. But that light will last virtually, literally, forever. Have you heard my rant about the... I mean, everybody's got a rant about people saying literally.
Yeah.
Turns out that one of the dictionaries has changed the definition of literally.
Oh no.
To it's still the first definition is the literally we think of when we're being anal about it. It means this is the way things really, really are. But the other definition is an exaggerated version of figuratively. Everybody who says, my head literally exploded.
I hope I'm not there for that.
Yeah. Yep. Obviously, they don't mean their head really, really, really exploded. But people say that so much that socially we have changed the definition of the word literally to mean an exaggerated version of figuratively.
It's very popular. It's very disturbing to me that, you know, popular usage determines correctness, or popularity determines correctness, and all sorts of things.
Why shouldn't it? Why shouldn't we decide what we want? Why should we? Why should we be beholden, be stuck with what people decided the way things should be generations, dozens of generations before we were born? Why can't we change things?
Well, because things of a physical nature are not subject to change. The rules of physics must apply. They're not suggestions or guidelines.
Evidently, you have not seen what the North Carolina legislature is deciding about the sea level changes coming up over the next 100 years on the coast.
No, but that's a liberal versus conservative debate. We shouldn't get into that. You and me should never be in a liberal versus conservative debate.
We shouldn't, but on the other hand, you are a man of science. And in that liberal-conservative divide, the things don't line up perfectly here, but there tends to be, on the conservative side of politics, a anti-science bias, which has got to cause you a bit of a problem.
It does. It does. I have a lot of heartburn over it.
Yeah. So here on the North Carolina coast, what they've determined is that it doesn't matter who's or what is causing global warming, because reacting to it would be expensive and cause real estate developers no end of grief and financial ruin. The sea level will not rise more than a foot in the next 100 years, not the 39 inches the scientists are predicting. So, you know, they are deciding the science politically
and financially.
Yeah. Yeah. it's not even all that political. It's probably all economic. So anyway, but we're seeing that the science versus ideology.
Yep.
So it happens. What the heck were we talking about?
PowerPoles, lighting.
Oh, yeah. So I need to switch that camera on now and adjust it. So I'm going to pause the television program for a moment because now everything's too bright.
Okay.
We're back in record. Okay, we're going to talk about PowerPoles.
Okay.
So what I was saying was that you can align them multiple ways. We were looking at that. Should I put the close-up camera on there?
Sure, sure. Yeah.
Okay.
They can be aligned vertically like that. They can be, and I've never seen anybody do that. You always see them aligned horizontally, but they can be two orientations, one like this.
You got to watch your monitor because you're getting out of camera range here. You're limited.
Like this.
Yep. Now, you can do once you've set things up like that is you can stack them using the slots and grooves on the top of what becomes the top and bottom. Right. And I believe somewhere in front of you, if you look around for it, you'll see a set of power poles that I've cobbled together that are stacked.
Well, they're not. That's they're not stacked though.
That's not it.
They can be stacked.
Yep, you're still out of frame. Watch your framing there. You're going to have to manipulate things while looking to your left. Yeah, that would be the way they could be stacked. So you could do that. Not a good reason to do that, but you can still attach individual connections to it, even though they're stuck together like that, as a fixed group. And that works pretty well.
I've got them quite tight now.
Yep.
Okay.
Sort of a problem.
Yeah.
One of the issues with power poles is sometimes they're too loose, sometimes they're too tight. So you got to find the Goldilocks combination. Sometimes I play with several. All right, so going back to holding up two of them together.
Okay.
In the horizontal configuration, and now swap them.
Well, let me just put another pair together, the other orientation.
Okay.
And you can see what happens when you try to mate them. Now, these are genderless connectors. You know what I mean by genderless?
That's the other thing that George didn't mention, is that you can have them on either end of the wire, and it doesn't matter. You don't have male, yeah. You don't have female. They will connect right. together in any configuration.
So. Yeah. That, I thought they were called genderless because connectors are named after their inventor, and these were invented by Fred Genderless.
You got that, exactly.
Okay.
So show what the problem is.
When we have them like this and you connect them, you see the problem immediately. We got red to black and black to red. Can't have that. Just by swapping one pair, like so. There we go.
It should be easy to do. It's not really easy to do.
They're a little fiddly. Now, when you connect them up, you can see.
Yeah.
You can see what you get.
And the very first time I encountered a situation where I was going to take advantage of the idea that we were all compatible and I was going to use someone else's power supply or car or something with my radio.
It was different.
they did it differently.
50-50 chance.
Yeah. It is. Why is it that whenever there's a 50-50 chance of things being right, 9 times out of 10, they're wrong?
I don't know. I'm sure there's a rule for that. It's a Murphy thing, maybe.
How do you decide which way to do it? I'm going to put your little camera up there again. How do you decide?
I scoured the web looking for information concerning the polarity of Anderson power poles, and what I found is that this is the most common arrangement. When viewed with the large part of the connector at the top, red is on the right. Also, when viewed from the wires, this is the direction the wires would come from. The other connectors would come in from this side. So
yep.
let me go ahead and put this pair together.
And the little mnemonic sort of, not really a mnemonic, but the phrase that I memorized for figuring out how to do it is red right, A up. And if you look very carefully, there's a little A embossed on on each one.
Yep.
And that's a good shot. You can see it even with that reflection. With the A up, the red should be on the right.
When viewed from the connector end, not the wire end.
You can't see the A from the wire end. You have to be able to see the A.
Oh, when you can see the A. Okay.
When it's staring you in the face, looking you in the eye.
Okay. All right, good.
As if the camera's eyes were yours, you can see the A. It should be up, and the red should be to the right.
Cool.
How did that become the standard?
I don't know. How did it get to be that way?
I have no idea.
I don't either.
I did the same thing you did. I scoured the web until I found what people were doing, and evidently, and I'm guessing there's more than one ham out there who has put them together in random fashion.
Who claims to be the authority.
Well, that could be too. If we had scoured the web just a little bit harder, we might have found some people who are claiming the other way is the right way.
Yeah, right.
To achieve the goal of everybody being compatible, it has to be decided one way, and that is it. I don't care what you think. That is it.
I agree.
Okay, so red right, A up.
Yep.
The other thing that George had trouble with was jamming wires into the connector. He decided to solder them and then had a hard time pushing them in. But he did show that there were several different sizes of the little spade lug. So and you can see them there. One is for wire that is, I think, 15, 18 gauge, somewhere in there, and one is for a little bit bigger. They call it 15 amp and 30 amp, but is the spade lug a different size, or are they the same size?
No, the blades are the same size.
Okay. So they'll carry about the same amount of current.
Yeah.
And they do make one that is a little bit bigger, and I don't have a sample of that. The only wires that I've ever had that needed the bigger connector are the ones on the really heavy-duty radios, the HF rigs. And all I did, if you can hold it up there, you'll see that, that the 30-amp one is split. Whoops. There's a little split down the collar. Still got that camera up a little bit too bright. I just stuck a screwdriver in there and opened the split up a little bit, and, mm-hmm. and everything got in there. I'm not sure 100%, but they call that the 45 amp is the bigger one.
Uh-huh.
I think that the blade terminal might be a little bigger on the 45 amp, but nothing I've got is over 30 amps.
Yeah,
it's just the wire is a little bit bigger.
I think it is. The slot in the crimper looks wider.
Stick that.
The crimper is sized for 15 amp, 30 amp, and the 45 amp, and the part where the blade goes in is wider for the 45. So I think you must be right. I've never worked with the 45 amp ones.
Yeah,
I can get 10 gauge in these 30 amp.
it'll still go in into the same connectors. Although they do have bigger connectors for mm-hmm. for bigger bigger jobs. So yeah. Since the radios don't draw 30 amps, unless you know, maybe one of the, an amplifier or something would, but the radios, the 100 watt HF rigs don't draw 30 amps.
No, 20.
So the 30 amp connector is fine. It's just that the 12 gauge wire that they've got on it won't fit in it unless you split that little collar open a little bit. And the other thing that the George he didn't have this fancy crimper. Show that fancy crimper
The West Mountain radio.
Yeah,
crimper, and to be honest with you, I've used better crimpers than this one.
Really?
Yeah,
but not I've got designed
some at work.
Not designed for power poles, just other crimp duty.
Just other pin crimpers that are generic standard pin crimpers that I've got from various places. I use them at work all the time.
Okay, so go ahead and stick that under the close-up camera.
Okay.
I mean, that, to me, that works pretty well.
Yeah.
And George was using sort of a generic crimper. He got a crimp, but he wasn't real happy with it, so he soldered his connections. Mm-hmm. I've been completely satisfied with the crimp that I get. I cannot pull things off.
Yeah.
So it's a very tight crimp. And it has a ratchet release just in case you go wrong. You start getting things wrong, you can back it off. So it's well designed. I forget what it cost. It was in the neighborhood of, what, $45 or so?
Yeah, about $50, I think.
Yeah, so it's not a cheap tool. Mm-mm. And it only does that one thing. You can't crimp other stuff with it.
Yeah, and it does have an adjustment for the amount of crimp you get right here. You can loosen the Phillips head screw and then rotate the ring around, and that's just how far it's going to go before it stops, you know, before the ratchet opens.
Okay, so... George, you missed a couple things, but if people were keeping score and looking at the stuff that we miss, it's all over the place.
Did you want to demonstrate this crimper?
You want to try that?
Sure.
Because it's a little wonky, but sure, give it a try. You got
it's
some
a little
wire.
Fiddly, but not too bad. Yeah, I got some wire here, some pins. What you want to do is...
Watch your framing there. You got off the top.
You just want to put the pin in the crimper, and notice how that blade is off to one side of the ferrule where you're going to crimp. You want that part down. And then just stick the wire in.
Yep. Now, George, one thing George did get... And you're actually using the wrong size blade, because you got a 30 amp blade, and that piece of wire will fit into the 15 better than it will the 30.
Yep. Yeah, what you gave me was two 30 amp blades and two 15 amp blades.
Yeah, but okay.
And one piece of wire.
All right. But before you crimp the other side, even before you crimp the first one, one of the things George really did right was he showed that you need to line things up so that the blade will be oriented properly to go into the shell.
Yeah.
Because you don't want to have to be twisting them around, okay. And they only go into the shell one way.
Let me do the crimp, and then I'll show how it happened.
Okay.
Because I'm going to put this one.
You had a plan.
Yeah. Oh, I got terrible tendonitis. Okay, I'm just going to switch hands here so I can...
So it's not too late? You haven't squashed it too much yet?
No.
Okay. It is. It is hard. That crimper is hard to close all the way.
Yeah, it doesn't have a lot of leverage there. Okay, let me go ahead and assemble the connectors. A up, red on the right. Now, I don't know. Yeah, you can see the little wire spring inside there. The bottom of this pin is going to hook over that wire spring, so it needs to be orientated this direction. When you crimp the pins on the wire, you want them so that when you slide them in, they're in this orientation so that the hook can snap over the wire. If they were, you know, well, the wires will be reversed now, but if you had crimped them so the wires were correct with the pins this way, you would have to twist them around, and that just weakens everything.
Okay.
So with it this way.
Now here you're going to reach the point where I have the most trouble, and that is that it, getting them pushed all the way in, and there should be a little click. In fact, now that you can't see it anymore, bring it up by your microphone so we can hear the click.
All right, here we go. First one side. And it didn't click. It's right in, right at the edge, but it didn't click. Let me get the other side most of the way in there.
I'm hearing your knuckles click more than the...
yeah, they're getting really old. I had a birthday since I saw you last, I think. Okay, let me push the black one in.
Oh. See, a lot of times I can't get them just pushing the wire. I can't get them to click in and be locked.
You have to reach in there with something and push the pin?
Yep.
Yeah.
A little screwdriver usually. Yep. And George was having that trouble too.
Yeah, and I might have to do the same thing here.
Can you get yourself back under the camera?
See, I've already got a good kink on that connection there.
Yeah.
And it would have been better if that hadn't happened like that.
Yep, so that's the trouble I have, and evidently that's sort of a generic problem because that may be too big a screwdriver. Maybe not.
Come on.
I'll also set things. Did it click in?
No, it didn't.
Yeah, so I also set things so that... if my screwdriver slips, I'm not going to shove it through the palm of my hand.
Oh, yeah. That ever since that Hurricane Fran incident.
Yeah. That's it. It's in there now. And you should be able to tug on those wires.
The black one did not click in. So Let me get it up here and push. There she goes.
Okay. Well, we heard that click loud and clear. Yeah. That was the click.
Yeah.
Okay, so back to your close-up camera.
Yeah.
And, yeah, you should be able to tug on those wires. And if you just tug on the bundle together, you might not be stressing the one of them. So you want to make sure you try them both together.
Yeah. Okay, and then for the 15 amp, just going to drop the pin in. The little thing there that sets the depth doesn't work near as well in the 15 amp.
Yeah, you're off the frame again. So
okay, the pin actually goes in too far.
When you do the next one, I'm going to go to your wide shot so everyone can see how much effort you have to put into to closing that crimper. Sometimes I'll put one handle on the desk and just push with both hands.
Now, I'm trying to pay attention to the orientation of the pins, you know, so they won't have to be twisted. There we go.
Well, you're still kind of out of frame, but I think we got the idea.
Jeez.
We need cameramen.
Yeah, you're going to fire me. All right. Let's just...
Okay, are you under the close-up camera there? There we go. So for that narrow wire, what gauge is that wire?
18, right.
Okay, yeah. So the 15 amp is a better fit.
Right.
Although the crimper crimped okay. it crimped down on the using the 30-amp
right. Yeah, spade. I can't pull the wire back out of it.
I keep switching to me when I mean to be switching to you. I'm going to have to stop criticizing Cliff for doing that. Are you back under the close-up? There you go.
Yeah, but you know what's going on here. The red one is good, and so is the black one. Yeah, they're in there.
Okay. All right. And so just for fun, connect them together.
Oh, you've got
the... And this is what is known as a phase-locked loop. Oh, yeah, there's an extra little fee-bob there that that you can show people.
I'm going to put a twist in it here. Just because that's the kind of guy I am there. There, now it's twisted.
That's for lightning protection.
Yeah. Yeah, and you've got a little keeper here.
Yeah, show how easy it is to pull them apart first. Yeah, so you can get a situation where you're out of frame again. Hmm. You can get a situation where the things that you're connecting together for power can have a little tension on the wire. You probably shouldn't. That wouldn't be a good idea, but it can happen. And in some cases, under a seat or something could be hard to reach, hard to see that that's what went on. So you can buy these little plastic fee-bobs that will go in to
It's a fee-bob?
Yeah. That will go in there and hold things together. And that'll snap in with a little bit of tension, I think.
And it's easy to pull that out, but you can't pull the connector apart while that's in there.
Yep. There's one more thing I want to show.
All right.
Y'all saw the episode that I did with Jim at Jim's Engraving, and he sent me my sign.
That looks good.
I'm suddenly reminded of the Blue Collar Comedy Tour. Here's your sign. That won't mean anything to people who haven't seen the Blue Collar Comedy Tour.
Yep.
So this is pretty cool. Let me show how this all goes together. This is a piece of glass, mirrored piece of glass. Inside the base is just a row of LEDs. So we're all LED all the time around here. You can talk, but I can't switch your picture because both of my hands are busy.
Okay.
I need Vox. Whoever talks, the picture comes up. That'll be cool. Okay, so inside here is the row of LEDs. This is not much until you have it on the LEDs. And then it's just super pretty.
Yeah.
On the back, the power is a little 12-volt wart down at the outlet. This is not power supply. This is an infrared controller. It does sort of a pass-through of the power, but it also sends instructions to the LEDs. And this is the receiver for the infrared.
So it's got a remote?
And this is the little remote.
Oh, my goodness.
And so I can change the color. And it can be a wide variety of colors. Stay by my microphone here. And then there's also the option to, well, you can go straight to white, although there we go, that's just white. Although being in LEDs, it looks kind of blue. On and off. And then some flashing modes, most of which are epilepsy-inducing.
Mm-hmm.
But this one is slow enough that it's probably not too bad.
Yeah.
And there's another one that's a little bit too fast. That's my favorite color. But
green?
Yeah, but I'll get tired of that after a while.
Well, that's pretty neat.
And but speaking of it flashing, here's some interesting thing. On the remote is two brightness buttons, brighter and darker. But watch what happens when I make it brighter. On the monitor.
Gets darker. Oh.
Maybe it's getting... I can't tell. It's flashing.
Yeah, it sure is.
Yeah, there's one spot. And so evidently what it's doing is it's changing the
duty cycle.
And of course a shorter duty cycle, it's going to get darker. And at some point it comes up to something where the camera, which is its shutter, is operating at 60 frames per second. is matching what the LEDs are doing. But otherwise, you see it kind of flash. So kind of stuck cool. with one. So there's other things that we could do, but we are out of time.
All right.
Somehow we have managed to fill up another hour of sterling ham radio programming. Yeah. So happy to do that. Thank you for coming by.
Oh, it's my
that's
pleasure.
That's your work space there. Is that going to be adequate for Jeff's technology moment?
Yeah. Well, you know, no matter what the size of the bench, the work area will always be one square yeah. foot.
Oh, you brought a couple of keys. You want to talk yeah. about them real quick?
Sure.
You want to shove them into the close-up camera.
All right. Okay, well, this is the Bunnell.
Watch your framing.
Whoops, this way. This is the keys are both from Jesse Bunnell's company, Bunnell. this is the Model W double speed key. It's a side swiper, and the way it works is both of the two contacts here are just connected together. So no matter which direction you push the lever, it makes contact. So it's like a straight key in that sense. And then you just operate it horizontally instead of vertically. The idea being for each element, you're just pushing either left or right and not down and up, thereby cutting the number of motion in half. So it's called a double speed key. This was the Model W. There was a Model G that predated this one, and the big difference between the Model G and the Model W is the Model W included this spring tension adjustment here, so you could make it stiffer or lighter. And the earlier Model G didn't have that. This was patented in 1888. Only 4 years later, the first bug was patented in 1892, so that was about the end of the side swiper, although they were manufactured right up until about 1920. So,
And the idea of that key is to eliminate some kind of a problem, I guess.
Yeah, the layman's term was glass arm. The fancy term was telegrapher's paralysis. Now they call it carpal tunnel syndrome.
Repetitive motion.
Repetitive motion. Yeah. Yep. Yep. The other one is also a Bunnell key here, and I'm not sure if this might be just about too big to fit in. This is the Bunnell Gold Bug here. This is there was about 1,200 of them made. This is serial number 144 here. Precipitated.
So he got on the bug
lawsuit.
Bandwagon.
He did.
Wait, I want to make some money here. I better make a bug.
And got sued for it.
Oh,
by Vibraplex. So they went to court. Vibraplex claimed that their bug, invented by Horace Martin, was that bug was included in the patent. The word bug. They were trying to patent the word bug and stop Jesse Bunnell from using it. And a judge said no.
Yeah, I don't think you can patent a word. You can trademark a word, but I don't think you can patent a word.
Yep, and that's what the judge evidently told Vibraplex.
Yeah, so I've been hearing for all the time I've been listening to Twit and stuff, you know, these patent wars.
Yeah.
Evidently, they're nothing new.
Yeah, I guess not.
Patent war has been going on for a long time.
And Jesse Bunnell waited until the Vibraplex patents on the bug had expired before he released this bug.
Okay.
So the action could never be called into question by a patent, but the name bug did.
So he was able to hang on long enough to stay in business and not violate the patent.
Yeah.
I guess patents last longer now.
I guess he lived. He lived to be 56. He wasn't an old man. He caught a cold.
Gee,
yeah.
Back in the day. Yeah. All right. So we have a Jeff's technology corner, a Jeff's telegraphy moment.
You have to come over and look at the Christmas lights and how I have de-blinked my LED lights.
You got a secret?
Just a bridge rectifier I made. They all run off a bridge rectifier. So they still blink, but they blink at 120 flashes a second instead of 60.
So you didn't make it, you didn't try to make it DC, but you made it.
Well, it's pulsating DC.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. But not straight DC. Just,
right.
So instead of AC, it's pulsing DC.
But it brightened them. So that had to be dealt with.
Okay. And so you put some resistance in line?
Yeah.
All right. Geek engineers do Christmas.
Yeah, you can light your whole house and yard and everything for about 15 watts.
Yep.
In fact, some of the X10 controlled switches wouldn't work because of the low power consumption. I ended up making some dummy loads to plug on just so the X10 switching that turns them on and off would work.
Yep. Now, there is something that I haven't investigated yet, but we're going to have to check out.
Okay.
And that is that RF-wise, some of these can be very noisy.
Oh, is that right?
Okay. Yeah. Okay. I don't know whether it's HF or VHF. The way things are in here right now, I have noise-generating stuff everywhere.
Yeah.
And on some bands, I see an S7 noise level. And on my mobile, I'll pull in and out of the garage, and as I get within a couple of feet of the side of the house, noise level goes up.
Yeah.
So I'm going to have to do some serious denoising. And, you know, I'll use the usual procedure. I'll get everything turned off. I'll run the radio on batteries. Expect the noise level to go down to nothing.
Right.
And step by step, I'll turn things on and see what's making noise.
And you're going to find is that there's a lot of things, each generating a little noise that adds up to a big S7.
Yeah. Yeah. Leo has got, I don't know if I can, I can't pull that out. I got one here. This little device is the thing that takes the HDMI that comes out of my cameras, converts it, and you can only go 30 feet or so with HDMI, and even at that, it's a big, heavy cable, and you really don't want to use it.
Right.
This converts it to serial digital. The serial digital signal goes through RG59 coax for hundreds of feet. So that's very cool. I can get the video out of my cameras and into the Wirecast system here. Can I see some of that here? You can sort of see along the side. This is where the input is, and you can see a bunch of wires, but just barely. This is noisy. And if you've watched much Twit back in the day when they were trying to get the ham stuff working, they just had a huge noise level. Well, some folks have driven around Petaluma and said that there's noise all over the place, but Leo's got like 50 of these things. They make a lot of noise. I think they make most of their noise at VHF, but one of the things that I'm going to have to play with and see if we can
Fun thing to do.
Now, we're wrapping this show up. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 107. Thank you for watching. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
Jeff Wittick, AC4ZO.
Say the first part.
And I'm Jeff Wittick.
No. I'd say the first part of the last thing we say. Because I always say it and you wrap it up.
Okay.
I'm reversing things. I'm pulling a reversal on you.
I've got it now. This is Jeff Wittick. I'm still Jeff Wittick, AC4ZO. Over.
And out.